Bibles today, if you would please, to the book of 1 Corinthians and chapter 10. And as you're turning to 1 Corinthians chapter 10, I want to welcome Jordan Smith visiting with us today. Good to have you here. Thank you for coming. Hope you'll come back again. I want you to know you're always welcome. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31, I'll begin with this morning. The Bible says, "Whether therefore ye eat or drink, or whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God." Let's bow, please, for a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning for the fine place that you've given us to meet in. We know, Father, that your people around the world are not all as blessed as we are with facilities like this to meet in. We know you have, we have brothers and sisters meeting in jungles and in caves and in huts and in open air around the world because they love you and they want to worship you. But we thank you for our country and the way you've prospered us and blessed us. We pray that you'd bring our country back to a closer walk with you, that, Father, we might see revival in America. But we do thank you for the good things you've blessed us with, and we don't want to take them for granted. Neither do we want to boast in them, for they are by your grace. But we do come this morning and ask that you might speak to our hearts by your Holy Spirit, through your word, for your glory. I pray, my Father, that you'd open the lips of your servant to speak in the heart of every person to receive the word of God. I pray for those who are watching on live stream, listening on the radio, that they would be blessed as well. And that, Father, everyone in this room would have ears and hearts to pay attention. And that, Lord, you might help us today to be more like you have us to be. We ask your blessing. We give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. In Jesus' name, amen. As Christians, we are called upon to do whatever we do as we live our lives for the glory of God. That's what the Bible says here. Why? Because of what he has done for us. The Bible says that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, and whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Because he gave his Son, and because the Son of God and God the Son, the Lord Jesus, came to earth and was willing to become sin for us, and die in our place and shed his blood to pay for our sins and to be buried in our tomb and rise again for our salvation, we ought to live for his glory. Because we were on our way to hell, now we're on our way to heaven. Because we were dead, but now we live, we ought to live for his glory. Why? Because we are bought with a price, the precious blood of Christ, the Bible says, and we are not our own. Why? Because anything and everything that we can do that is of true value is produced by him through us, by his grace, and by his Spirit. The world of men at large is estranged from God and living their lives for and by themselves. And all the glory is their own glory. They do what they do to glorify themselves. But God said in Isaiah chapter 42, "I am the Lord, that is my name, and my glory will I not give to another, neither my praise to graven images." And in 1 Corinthians 4, verse 7, the Bible says, "For who maketh thee to differ from another? And what hast thou that thou didst not receive? Now if thou didst receive it, why dost thou glory as if thou hast not received it?" God is saying we really, when we cut it right down, we don't have anything to glory of in ourselves. Because everything we have, we've received it. Even our life, even the air we breathe, everything we have, we've received. And yet we glory as if we did not receive it. And so we, therefore, who are saved, ought to understand. And we ought to live our lives as a life of gratitude whereby we should glorify God in all that we do. I believe we can glorify him by working at providing a few things that he wants. And I'm just going to look at three things this morning that God wants. And if we want to glorify him, we'll be involved in seeing that we're working toward God getting what he wants. Number one, I want you to turn with me to Luke chapter 14, please. Luke chapter 14, we'll read at verse 15. And my first point this morning is this: God wants a full house.
Amen.
Luke 14, verse 15. And when one of them that sat at meat with him heard these things, he said unto him, Blessed is he that shall eat bread in the kingdom of God. Then said he, that's Jesus, to him, A certain man made a great supper and bade many, and sent his servant at supper time to say to them that were bidden, Come, for all things are now ready. And they all with one consent began to make excuse. The first said unto him, I bought a piece of ground, and I must needs go and see it. I pray thee have me excused. And another said, I have bought five yoke of oxen, and I go to prove them. I pray thee have me excused. And another said, I have married a wife, and therefore I cannot come. So that servant came and showed his lord these things. Then the master of the house, being angry, said to his servant, Go out quickly into the streets and lanes of the city, and bring in hither the poor, and the maimed, and the halt, and the blind. And the servant said, Lord, it is done as thou hast commanded, and yet there is room. And the lord said unto the servant, Go out into the highways and hedges, and compel them to come in, that my house may be filled. You see every chair in this room? God wants them all filled.
Amen.
And what are they? And when they are filled, God will give us room for more chairs to put people in. What do you think honors and glorifies God more, a full house or less than full house? What do you think impresses saints and sinners alike, a full house or a less than full house? Oh, so you want to impress people, do you? Only for the glory of God. How are we going to reach people? We reach people by impressing people with the gospel. And how do we impress people with the gospel? By impressing them with what God has done. Don't we want people to come back? Don't we want people to stay? Don't we want people to become part of the ministry and get involved and serve the Lord?
Amen.
There's an old saying that if you're in a town and you really haven't been there before and you don't know what's a good restaurant and what isn't a good restaurant, there's an old saying that says you go to the restaurant that has the most cars in the parking lot because that's probably where the best food is served. And so when people come into a house and it's empty, you think they're going to come back? But if they come into a house that's full and people are there and people are excited and people want to be there and people have a spirit of God on them, maybe they'll come back. God wants a full house. Now listen, we're not willing to compromise to fill the house. But we sure could work a whole lot more at filling it. Look at verses 19 and 20 of our text. And another said, I bought five yoke of oxen, and I go to prove them. I pray thee have me excused. And another said, I have married a wife, and therefore I cannot come. What do we have in these verses? We have excuses, don't we? And we are all familiar with hearing excuses why people won't come to church. We're familiar with people with excuses why they think they can't go to church. You know, people say, well, I don't have time to go to church. Really? You're that scheduled on Sunday. You can't come to church in the morning. No, I work in the morning. How about in the evening? Yeah, I'm busy Sunday. I can't come Sunday morning. I can't come Sunday evening. How about Wednesday evening?
Amen.
Excuses aren't new. People have been making excuses from the beginning of mankind. As a matter of fact, when Adam sinned, the first thing he did was made an excuse.
Yeah.
It's that wife you gave me. Right? And then she made an excuse. Ah, it's that serpent. The great man that was having a great supper sent his servant out and he said, I want you to get people to come in here. I want my house to be full. But one after another made an excuse. One after another made an excuse. One after another made an excuse. Get used to it. That's how it is. But you don't quit. The servant went back to the master and he said, they won't come. And he said, all right, listen, we're not going to give up. We've got a good supper on the table. We want people to come and eat that supper. And so we're going to go out and we're going to get whoever come. You go get the people nobody else wants. You go get the blind, and you go get the halt, and you go get the poor. You go get the people loving the unlovable, touching the untouchable, reaching the unreachable. Go out and get them. Get them in here.
Amen.
And so he went out, and he brought in all the blind, and all the maimed, and all the halt, and all the poor that he could find. And yet there was still room. This guy had a pretty big place. And so he said to him in verse 23, and the Lord said unto the servant, go out into the highways and hedges. He said, I want you to go out and look in every cranny. I want you to go out and look down every alley. I want you to look behind every building. I want you to knock on every door. I want you to go to every place you can see where might be people. The highways, the hedges, people sleeping under the hedge. Get them, pull them in here. He said, compel them to come in. Now, the word compel is the word anagkodzo. It means this, to constrain, whether by threat or entreaty or force or persuasion. And so we can constrain people by threat. How in the world are you going to do that? Don't threaten to beat people up if they won't come to church. You know what you can threaten them with? Eternity in hell. Huh? Threaten them with the truth. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The wages of sin is death. And death and hell was cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. You want to know how you can escape that eternal torment? Why don't you come to church Sunday? How about we constrain them by entreaty? Why don't we ask? When's the last time you asked somebody, hey, listen, I'm going to invite you to come to my church this Sunday. Well, I'm busy. Oh, I'm telling you, you ought to come. You won't believe what you hear. Look, don't tell them it's boring. Just tell them to come. Don't tell them the preacher doesn't preach good. Just tell them to come. Once you get them in, then you can give them the gospel, right?
Amen.
Entreat them. Invite them again and again. Go to your neighbor and say, hey, I want to invite you to come to church Sunday. Hey, I want you to come to special meetings. Hey, I want you to come to this. I want you to come to that. Constrain them by force. That's part of the definition. Now, the only people you can constrain by force are your children. You ought to make your children come to church.
Amen.
Well, I don't want to force my children to go to church. Do you force them to go to school? I mean, in the morning, do they just jump out of bed and say, "Woo! I can't wait to go to school today." Some of them do, but most of them don't. Right? I mean, your children, when summer vacation comes by, they don't go, "Oh, school's over, summer vacation, bummer. Mom, I'd like to go to school all year long." But you make them go to school, don't you? But when it comes to church, we say, "Well, I don't want to drag my kid to church." Where else? You drag him everywhere else? Why don't you drag him to church?
Amen.
How about if we constrain them by persuasion? Persuade people to come. Bring them on special church days. And here's one. Why don't you say to somebody, listen, you know what I'd like for my birthday? I'd like you to come to church with me on Sunday morning. That's the only birthday present I want. You know what I want for Christmas? I'd like you to come to church with me on a Sunday morning. That's all I want. Nothing else. Just come to church with me on Christmas. Persuade them. You can figure it out. You persuade people to do other things. We entreat people to do other things. Why don't we persuade them to come to church? The Lord's desire here is that my house may be filled. And let me just say this before I move on to point number two. God not only wants his house full of people, but he also wants his house full of meat. Malachi chapter 3 verse 10 says, bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in mine house, and prove me now herewith, saith the Lord of hosts, that if I will not open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive. God did not want his house to lack, and it was up to the children, it was up to the people of God to see that that did not happen. God wanted his house to be full, and he wanted his people to see that it got full. This is God's house. He's given it to us. It's our responsibility to make sure that its needs are met and to make sure that the house is full. We're not working too hard at it. There's too many empty spaces. That's what Saturday soul winning and visitation is all about. Amen. That's what witnessing is all about, getting them in. Why? Just for numbers? Just for offerings? No. Every person is a soul. Amen? Either saved or lost, they are an eternal soul. And I can't think of anywhere better for a soul to be on a Sunday morning than in a Bible-believing, gospel-preaching church. Can you? What will they get for eternity at the ballpark? What will they get for eternity on the couch watching TV? What will they get for eternity somewhere else? We need to bring them somewhere they can get something that'll last forever. Amen? You know, if they're lost, maybe they'll get saved. And if they're saved, maybe they'll get plugged into a local church and grow and serve the Lord. Maybe they'll do something for Jesus with their life. God wants his house to be full. Second thing, go back to Luke chapter 10. Not only does he want his house to be full, but Luke chapter 10, verse 1, the Bible says he wants a full harvest. Not only does he want a full house, he wants a full harvest. Look what it says. After these things, the Lord appointed other 70 also and sent them two and two before his face into every city and place whither he himself would come. Therefore said he unto them, the harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he would send forth laborers into his harvest. You know, we usually look at verse 2 and think that God will send some new people our way. The truth is that the ones to whom the Lord Jesus is speaking right here are the ones that he's sending into the field. The 70 disciples mentioned here are being sent into the harvest field, and the Lord is telling them that they will need some help. So pray for help. He said, I'm sending you out. There's 70 of you. But the job's too big. The field is too huge. He said, we need more labor. So as you're going and as you're serving and as you're talking to people about me, you pray for more servants. You pray for more laborers. But the important thing to remember is that they themselves are going into the field. How can we sit in a comfortable cozy with a cup of coffee and pray for God to send someone to soul winning on Saturday? Did you hear what I just said? Or how can we sit and just do nothing, be couch potatoes, so to speak, and pray for God? Well, Lord, I'll pray you'll send people to our church this morning for Sunday morning. Boy, the preacher'd like to see it filled up. We need to see those seats filled in, Lord. You send people. You know what he says? I sent you to go invite people.
Amen.
The master doesn't go out into the field. The servants do.
Amen.
He said, that's your job. Now, I'll give you the power,
amen,
and I'll be with you, but I'm not going to do your job. What glorifies God more, a harvest field full of laborers or a harvest field bereft? What glorifies God more, a harvest field full of laborers or empty spaces filled in with excuses? And we have excuses. Me too. If you ever need some excuses, you come see me. I can give you all the excuses you need. And we have empty excuses that we give God why we can't go to church, number one. And then we have empty excuses why we can't go and tell somebody about Jesus. Why we can't go out on soul winning on Saturday. Why we can't hand out a tract. Why we can't invite somebody to church. Why we can't be counted on. And the truth is, Our excuses that we have are as flimsy as the excuses that we saw in Luke.
That's right.
How can we, week after week and month after month, come up with excuses why we can't go while we expect others to go? And if we think it's not important, just hear what the Word of God says. Proverbs 10:5. He that gathereth in summer is a wise son, but he that sleepeth in harvest is a son that causeth shame. Jesus looked out onto the fields, and he saw souls, didn't he? And he said, the fields are white already unto harvest. And we make excuses why we can't go. But the Bible says, he that gathereth in summer is a wise son. Listen, this is the summertime, friends. We are here on planet Earth, and we only have so many years left, and it's summer, and the wise son will be out in the harvest fields telling people about Jesus, compelling people to come in, inviting people to Christ, passing out tracts, knocking on doors, telling their coworkers, their fellow students, their family. That's why we're here. Well, that's the pastor's job. Yeah, but you know what he said? Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he'll send forth laborers into his harvest. I need help.
Amen.
Well, that's those people on Saturday. That's the soul winner's job. Yeah, they need help.
Amen.
The Lord needs help. Getting the word out. Psalm 126:6 says, he that goeth forth and weepeth, bearing precious seed, shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing his sheaves with him. You're never going to bring anybody with you if you never go get somebody. You understand? And you know, you may invite somebody time after time after time after time, but you know what? You may give somebody a track, you may give somebody an invitation, and they might not come, they might not come, they might not come, but then something will happen in their life. And all of a sudden, they're thinking about God. All of a sudden, they're thinking about death. All of a sudden, they're thinking about eternity. And where do you think they're going to go? They'll go to the place that someone cared enough to come to them. You understand what I'm saying? It might be years from now before that person that you gave that tract to actually comes to church. But if you never gave it to them, would they have ever come? Would they have ever known? You can't have a harvest without sowing. And you can't have sowing without going. Actually, when a person prays for laborers for the harvest, he or she is part of the answer to their prayer. Right? If you will start praying, Lord, we need more people to go out on Saturday and tell people about Jesus. Lord, we need more people witnessing. You say that, and God's going to start tapping on your shoulder and saying, you're more people. How about you? Oh, well, Lord, I'm not very good at stuff like that. Neither was Moses. Look how I used him. If you won't listen to call, then why should someone else? If you won't go, why should someone else? If you won't witness, why should somebody else? If you won't invite people, why should somebody else? You say, I'm afraid. Well, look at verse 3 of our text here. Luke chapter 10, look at verse. You say, I'm afraid to do that. I'm afraid to go knock on a door. I'm afraid to hand somebody a tract. I'm afraid to tell somebody about Jesus. Look what it says here. Go your ways. Behold, I send you forth as what? Lambs among wolves. Whoa. He didn't soft soap it, did he? Listen, folks, when we go out these doors, we're going like lambs among wolves.
That's right.
But you know what God told Joshua when Joshua was afraid? He said this, have not I commanded thee? Be strong and of a good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed, for the Lord thy God is with thee whithersoever thou goest. He said, Joshua, I want you to take the people on in. Joshua said, oh, man, I'm scared. I'm afraid. He said, don't worry, I'm going with you. And when Joshua knew God was going with him, he said, let's go. You know what God told King Jehoshaphat when he was afraid? In 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 15, and he said, "Hearken, ye all Judah, and ye inhabitants of Jerusalem, and thou, King Jehoshaphat, thus saith the Lord unto you, be not afraid nor dismayed by reason of this great multitude, for the battle is not yours, but God's." When it's time to go, we don't go by ourselves. When it's time to go, we don't go in our own power. It's God's field, it's God's battle. He just wants us to go. You know, four times the Lord Jesus told his disciples, be not afraid, be not afraid, be not afraid, be not afraid. But we be afraid. In Romans 13, 12, the Bible says, the night is far spent, the day is at hand. John 9, 4, I must work the works of him that sent me while it is day. The night cometh when no man can work. Do you understand, dear Christian? If we keep making excuses after excuses after excuses, we're going to get into the night and then the night will be our excuse. So it might be the night of our ability. Maybe there'll come a time in your life where you won't be able to go. So you should have went when you could. Amen?
Amen?
It might be the night of your age. It might come a point where your just old body just won't go no more. And you're just too old to go. Or you're too broke down to go. That's why he said, go now while it's the day. The night cometh when no man worketh. We keep putting it off, putting it off, putting it off. And then pretty soon the opportunity is gone. Or the ability is gone. Oh, I'm going to cut that grass. Yes, sir, I'm going to cut that grass. Yes, sir, I'm going to cut. Oh, it's too dark out. Can't cut the grass now. 2 Corinthians 6:2. Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. There are people out there ready to get saved today.
That's right.
Somebody needs to go tell them about Jesus. You know, it might be a coworker that's ready to get saved. You don't even know it. And you won't never know it if you don't open your mouth. I remember one time I was on a hospital visit, and someone had told me about a relative of theirs that was this mean, cantankerous person that, you know, they described him to me, and it was like, whoa, I hope I never meet that guy. I'm on a hospital visit, and the person there was a relative of the person that was talking to me, and they were talking to the person. I just went along for moral support, and I'm just leaning against the wall like this, and here's this guy sitting right here. And I said, hi, I'm Pastor Alquist. And he said, hi, I'm so-and-so. It was him. I went, whoa. And the Lord said, why aren't you going to witness to him? I said, well, that's, do you know who that is, Lord? That's so-and-so. Lord said, I know who it is. I said, yeah, but I'm afraid. The Lord said, you better talk to him. I said, okay, Lord, I'll talk to him. And I said, sir, do you know for sure you're going to heaven? And he said, no. I said, well, would you like to? He said, yes.
Amen.
I said, what? He said, yeah. So I told him right there, out loud, how to be saved. Room full of people. I said, you want to trust Christ your Savior? He said, yeah. I said, out loud? He said, yeah.
Amen.
Guy ended up getting saved, got baptized, became a member of the church.
Amen.
Became a soul winner. Yeah. People are ready to get saved right now. I remember a lady called me up and asked me if I'd go visit this young lady. She's 23 years old. She's in a nursing home. She was dying of leukemia. And they said, would you go tell her about Jesus? And I said, well, yeah, I'll go tell her about Jesus. So I went over to tell her about Jesus. And I'm walking down the hallway of that nursing home. I got my Bible in my hand. I'm going to tell her about Jesus. I come to the door. I look in. It's full of people. I just kept walking. I said, Lord, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to go have lunch. And when I come back, I'm going to go in there and witness to that girl. So I went and had a long lunch. I figured by the time I had lunch, all those people would be gone, right? So I had my long lunch. I got my Bible in my hand, going down that hallway. I look in that room. They're still there.
Oh.
And the Lord said, you promised. I said, all right. So I went in. And I went up to, and nobody knows me. I don't know nobody. And I go up, and there's that girl laying on the bed, and I introduced myself. And I said to her, do you know for sure you're going to heaven? She said, no. I said, would you like to? She said, yes. I led her to Christ right there. She died a couple days later. When's the acceptable time? Now! Behold, now's the day of salvation. There are people that are ready and willing to get saved right now, but they won't if we don't talk to them, if we don't go. I went into a hospital one time to visit somebody, and they weren't in their room. And I looked over, and here's this little old man. And he was all shriveled up in a fetal position, stark raving naked, right there on top of the bed. Oh, man, I felt so sorry for him. I went over, and I took his sheet, and I pulled it up over him. And I said, sir? He said, yes. I said, do you know for sure you're going to heaven? He said, no. I said, would you like to? He started weeping. He said, yes. I've always wanted to know, but there was nobody that would tell me. I led him to Christ. See, now's the accepted time. Behold, now's the day of salvation. But if you don't go, you can't sow. And if you don't sow, you can't reap. In John chapter 4, verse 35, Jesus said, say not ye, there are yet 4 months, and then cometh harvest? Behold, I say unto you, lift up your eyes and look on the fields, for they are white already to harvest. Jesus is saying there are people out there waiting for someone to come and tell them the truth of the gospel of salvation by grace through faith. There is a house and there is a harvest field, and they are to be filled. Isaiah 6:8 says, also I heard the voice of the Lord saying, who shall I send and who will go for us? You know, he's still asking that same question. He's asking that question to this congregation. God's saying, who's going to go for me? He's saying, see all these empty seats? Who will go and fill my house? He's saying there are lost souls all around you dying and going to hell, and some are ready to be saved. Who will go for me? Who will go for me? There's a house he wants to fill. And there's a harvest field he wants to fill with laborers. But here's the real crux of the matter. Luke chapter 10. I want to look at verses 26 through 28. That's not my verse, I'm sorry. But I do want to share the point with you. Point number 3, God wants a full heart. You know, and we'll get to this. God saved us by His grace, didn't He? He wants a full house. And He wants a harvest field full of laborers. But He's not going to have a full house, and He's not going to have a full harvest field until He gets our full heart. God wants full hearts. He saved us by His grace. The Bible says, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And the Lord Jesus said this, I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish. So we are neither saved by our own works, nor are we kept by our own works. It's the grace of God. There's nothing a human being can do to earn or deserve salvation, and nothing he or she can do to keep from losing it. It's eternal life. God does not hold salvation or heaven or eternal life over our heads to threaten its loss if we do not perform to certain standards. God does not hold your salvation over your head and say, well, if you don't live a certain way, you're going to lose this. He said, I give unto them eternal life and they shall never perish. God does not use salvation as a leverage against us to keep us in line. Why? Because God's not like us. That's why. That's what we do. That's not what God does. When God gives a gift, He gives a gift. And when He says it's eternal, it's eternal. God wants us to respond by faith. And in love. He wants our hearts to be in it. He does not want forced labor. He does not want lip service. Matthew 15:8 says, "This people draweth nigh unto me with their lips, their mouth, and honoreth me with their lips, but their heart is far from me." It's not the honor of lips that the Lord desires. He doesn't need empty honor. He doesn't need pretend accolades. He wants honor from our hearts. We listen to the lips. He looks upon the heart. Genesis 6:5, God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of their heart was only evil continually. Lips are outward, hearts are inward. Psalm 139:23, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts." You can lie with lips, but you cannot lie with your heart. Matthew 9:4, "And Jesus, knowing their thoughts, said, Wherefore think ye evil in your hearts?" They were lying with their lips, and Jesus was looking right at their heart. In Luke 24:38, "And he said unto them, Why are ye troubled, and why do thoughts arise in your hearts?" Luke 5:22, "But when Jesus perceived their thoughts, he answering said unto them, What reason ye in your hearts?" I want you to notice that all the verses I just read use the words thoughts and thinking and reasoning in association with the heart, not the mind. Did you catch it? He said, "Why are you thinking that in your heart? I see you thinking that in your heart. Why reason ye in your hearts?" He didn't say mind, he said heart. The use of the word heart signifies the innermost part of our being. It's talking about our core. Not the outward you. Not the you that is packaged for public consumption. But the real you. The innermost you. The essence of you. We say things like, "We need to get to the heart of the matter." Or, "We need to get to the heart of this problem." Or "What's the heart of the issue?" What are we saying? Does an issue have a blood-pumping heart? No. We're talking about the core, right? We're talking right down to the innermost truth of the matter. The brain is the organ that we use to think with, but the heart is the inner core that does the thinking. You following me? I'm not talking about a physical organ. I'm talking about the inner man. It's much deeper than a physical organ. I'm talking about that part of us which makes us human, that makes us distinct from all other species on planet Earth. And that's what makes us created in the image of God. We have a heart. We have a core. We have an inner man. That part of us which chooses self over God and rebellion over obedience and distrust over trust and doubt over faith and hate over love. That part of us. He said, "You can say what you want with your lips, but I'm looking in your heart and I see the truth." As a matter of fact, our entire relationship with God is to be from the heart. Colossians 3:23, "And whatsoever ye do, do it heartily, from the heart, as to the Lord, and not unto men." Do you know we're to believe with all our heart? Acts 8:37, "And Philip said, If thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest." Do you know that we are supposed to believe in our heart? Romans chapter 10 says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness. It's not a mere mental assent. It's an acceptance from the very core of my being. It's believing God in the inner man. We're supposed to praise him with all our heart. Psalm 86:12, "I will praise thee, O Lord my God, with all my heart." or trust him with all our heart. Proverbs 3:5, trust in the Lord with all thine heart. We're to love him with all our heart. Deuteronomy 6:5, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart. We're supposed to serve the Lord with all our heart. Deuteronomy 10:12, and now, Israel, what doth the Lord thy God require of thee but to fear the Lord thy God and to walk in all his ways and to love him and to serve the Lord thy God with all thy heart. We're supposed to give with all our heart. Exodus 25:2, speak unto the children of Israel that they may bring me offerings of every man that giveth it willingly with his heart. Ye shall take my offerings. He didn't want anybody coming in there and in their heart saying, I wish I didn't have to do this, but I'll do it because I have to. Listen, you put anything in that offering with that attitude, it ain't doing you any good. It'll do us some good, but it ain't going to do you any good. Because God won't accept it. I'll accept it. Yeah, I'll accept it because I can't see your heart. I'll accept it. We'll do something with it. But God says, I don't accept that. You didn't give that to me with all your heart. You just threw it in there because you thought you had to make yourself look good. You know we're supposed to obey him with all our heart? Psalm 119, verse 34. Give me understanding that I shall keep thy law. Yea, I shall observe it with my whole heart. Are you getting the picture? God wants truth in the inward parts. He wants us to do these things with all our heart. Witnessing and soul winning is to be from the heart. Going out into the labor field, into the harvest field, is to be with our heart. Inviting people and bringing people into his house should be done from our heart. When God gets a hold of your heart, then you will want his field with laborers. When God gets a hold of your heart, then you'll want his house filled with souls. When God gets a hold of your heart, then you'll want to also be about the Father's business as was Jesus, even as a young lad. When God gets a hold of your heart, then you will not have to be cajoled and browbeaten to obey or to serve or to give or to go out into the highways, hedges, because where your heart is, there will your treasure be also. What do you think glorifies God? Having more of your heart or less of your heart? Folks, we just need to get a heart.
Amen.
A heart for his house.
That's right.
And a heart for the harvest.
Amen.
And that'll glorify God. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. No one looking around. Maybe today as we think about these things that the Lord's concerned about, we should concern ourselves with the same things he's concerned about. What's he concerned about? Having a full house. What's he concerned about? Having a full field of laborers. What's he concerned about? Having your full heart. Maybe this morning as we have this invitation as a Christian, you'd just like to come and say, Lord, I want you to have more of my heart. I want my life to be one that's truly lived from the core of my being, not just from the peripheral edges of myself. Lord, I want you to work a miracle in my heart. Take more of it. Maybe you're here this morning and you've never been saved. You've never been born again. You heard me talk about people who got saved, but you've never been saved. You do not know for sure you're going to heaven when you die. My dear friend, I want you to understand, you can be saved right where you sit if you'll believe with your heart on the Lord Jesus Christ, if you'll trust him as your Savior, if you'll confess to him that you need him and ask him, he'll come. And he'll give unto you eternal life and you'll never perish. And you say, preacher, I'd like to do that. I know I need to be saved and I know I've been thinking about this and I think now's the time and this is the place and I'd like to trust Christ as my Savior. I'll help you if you want me to. You can pray right there in your seat, and I'll help you. If that's what you'd like to do, I want you to look up at me. Just look up at me. Let me see your face. And by looking at you, I'll know that this is the time that God brought you here so you could hear how to be saved and go to heaven, and you could make the most important decision of your life. Anybody like that here today? Say, yep, I need that. I need Jesus. And I want to take him right now as my Savior. Anybody like that here this morning? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you today. Father, we're glad for those who are here. They've come out to honor you with their presence. Father, there are a lot of empty chairs here. Would you help us to have a heart to fill them up? And Father, there are a lot of people who live all around us and work all around us, interact with us, and they're lost and on their way to hell. Would you give us a heart to tell them about Jesus? Invite them to church. Father, would you take our hearts and have more of them? There's so many things and so many others that have places in our heart that should be a place where you should be. I pray you'd help us to have a heart cleaning. And Father, we'll take out some of the garbage and we'll give you the rightful place. Help us not to be lip service Christians, but be heart Christians. Guide and direct in our invitation, Lord, as only you can. And we'll give you the honor and the glory and the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand, please. We're going to sing number 625, Look to the Lamb of God. And that's what we need to do. We need to look to Him. He's the one who will help you. He's the one that can enable you. He's the one that will use you. And maybe you'd like to come this morning and say, Lord, here am I. Thank you for reminding me. Thank you for letting me see it. And maybe you need to come and say, Lord, if I'm honest with you, you already know because you've already looked in my heart. I want to give you more of my heart, more of my life. I want you to be greater in my life than you've ever been before. I want you to use me more than you've ever used me before. And Lord, I'm afraid, but you said you'd go with me. So I'm going to go. There might be somebody in your mind right now that you know God wants you to invite to church. Why don't you come bring that name right here? Say, Lord, I'm going to go to invite them, prepare them. There might be somebody in your mind right now that you know God wants you to witness to about Jesus, tell them how to be saved, and you've been scared to death. Why don't you bring that name right here and say, Lord, I'm scared to death, but I know you want me to talk to this person, prepare their heart, and give me words, and then go do it by the grace of God. We're going to sing. You come as the Lord leads.
354, 354.
You from sin are longing to be free, look to the Lamb of God. He to redeem you died on Calvary, look to the Lamb of God. Look to the Lamb of God. Look to the Lamb of God. For he alone is to the Lamb of God.
Well, when will it be? Well, maybe you're a young person. You say, well, you know, I'm going to wait till I get out of high school. Then you'll say, well, I'll wait till I get out of college. Well, I'll wait till I get my career started. Well, I'll wait till after I raise my family. Well, I'll wait till after I retire. And then you wake up and say, oops, too late. It's too dark now in my life. I've lost all that time and opportunity. I'm going to tell you, folks, you're going to get older. You're going to get old faster than you think you are. Take my word for it. Just don't look back with a bunch of regrets and say, I wish I would have lived for Jesus. I wish I would have witnessed for Jesus. I wish I would have been more faithful. Work, for the night is coming. Work while it is yet day. We're going to sing that last stanza. If you need to come and pray about something or make a decision or talk to God, altar's open on the last.
Fear not when shadows on your pathway fall. Look to the Lamb of God. In joy or sorrow, Christ is all in all. Look to the Lamb of God. Look to the Lamb of God. Look to the Lamb of God. For he alone is able to save you. Look to the Lamb of God.
All right, you may be seated just for a few more minutes. We're almost done. This is Soul Winning Sunday. We've got some things to share with you, some awards to give out, and then we'll be gone. All right, I want to tell you, we've had this year, we've had people from 15 different states visit in 2016. We've had people from four different countries visit who were not missionaries. And we've had people from 29 different cities in the United States, or in Pennsylvania, 29 cities in Pennsylvania came and visited here. And we had 271 visitors, first-time visitors, in 2016. I just wanted to bring that to your attention. Now, what we're going to do is, today's Soul Winning Sunday, so there's a couple things we're going to do, and I'll try to do it as quickly as we can. I just want to remind you, this is the Lord's Day, so... All right. Number one, we're starting a new year, and we're going to try to, Pastor Cole made this idea the other day, and what this is a prayer wheel, and there are half-hour segments on this wheel from 9 a.m. to 9 p.m., and the Bible says, and now when the even was come, because it was the preparation, that is the day before the Sabbath, the Jewish people have a day of preparation, or they prepare for the Sabbath. And we ought to have a day of preparation to prepare for the Lord's Day, shouldn't we? Saturday would be a good day to do that. And so what I'd like to ask you to do is I'm going to put this out on the table, and I want you to put your name in one of these slots. And that means every Saturday you're going to pray at that time. And then there's also a prayer sheet. The prayer sheets will be on the table. You take one of those, it tells you things to pray for and pray about. And so you, at that hour, every Saturday, you get that out and you pray for what's on here as well as what God puts on your heart. One of the things that we're praying for is that our average attendance this year has been 160 on a Sunday morning. That's our average attendance. In 2011, our average attendance was 190. 2012, 187. 2014, 173. 2015, 165. 2016, 160. Do you see an alarming trend? We need to start that going in the other direction. Prayer. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. So if you'd like, we're going to put this out there. I want you to sign it. I want you to be praying for our Sunday services and the things that are on here, okay? That's what we're going to put out there. Our goal for 2017 is to have an average attendance of 185. 185. That means we'll have 25 more people. That's not very many. That wouldn't even fill up this section over here. Think we can do it?
Amen.
I know we can do it. We're going to have to sow. And to sow, we're going to have to go. Okay. At this time, I'd like to give out some awards. Now, we have the Teen of the Year. So I'd like to have the Teen of the Year. When I call your name, I'd like you to come up here. And you can hold the plaque that has your name on it. It's going to go on the wall on our out there. Teen of the Year for 2016, Jenna Sabinski. Where's she at? See, she's serving. That's why she's Teen of the Year. Would you go get her, please? All right. She's downstairs serving. We're going to have her come up. This is called the Go Forth plaque. And this is individuals who sign up. And we're going to do that in a minute. But sign up to go out once a month, every month. That means they go out 12 times. Now, they go out more than 12 times, but they'll go out at least 12 times. I'd like the following people to come up because they are on here. Rick McGachran, he's sick. He's at home. Darcy Quirk. Mike Quirk. David Rastatter. Abigail Stutzman. And Brett Stutzman. All right, these are people who put their name on the list every month. Come on up here. All right, your names are on this plaque. This will go on the wall. And Rick, I hope you're watching on live stream because you're supposed to be up here. Here comes Jenna. Come on up here, Jenna. You are the Teen of the Year. Stand there and hold that. All right, this next plaque is for teams. It's called 2x2s. And that's how the Lord Jesus sent out the 70, 2x2. And so these are teams of individuals who went out at least once a month, every month. Only one did it this year, only one. That was Dave Rastatter, right here, and Rick McAkron, who's sick and watching on live stream. So let's give them a hand. Now, this is Soul Winner of the Year. Now, Soul Winner of the Year doesn't mean the person who led the most people to Jesus. This is a composite. It shows a heart for getting people to Jesus. And the individual's name who's on here has brought more people to church in 2016 than any other single person. This person has seen more of the people they've brought to church saved than any other person in 2016. And that person is also sick today. But it was Emily Farringer.
Amen.
Let's give Emily a hand. So Emily, if you're watching on live stream, we wish you were here. We'll have you up here and show you this award when you're feeling better and back to church. All right, so these, don't forget the prayer wheel will be out on the table, signed for half in a slot every Saturday. Okay, every Saturday. You folks can be seated. Every Saturday you're going to pray. Now, we're going to sign up. These are going to be on the table. We're not going to all sign up up here, but these are going to be on the table in the foyer. First of all, we're going to have people who say, "Preacher, by the grace of God, I'm going to go out and at least once a month, one Saturday a month, every month of 2017. If you're one of those individuals and you would like to sign up, why don't you come up here? Individuals, come up. You're saying, you're going to come up and stand on a platform and you're going to say, "Listen, I, by the grace of God, am covenanting to go out at least once a month, one Saturday a month, for 12 months. Come on up and stand here. You're going to put your name right here where it says individuals. Okay? You're going to sign this in. And then every week, there will be a form for you to put your name on in the Welcome Center when you come out. Okay. Now, this next group is teams. I've asked you to get teams together to go out two by two. So if you are going to be a team this year, I want you to stand next to your partner. If you know who your partner is going to be, Pastor Rivera, you're my partner for going out. We have Rick is your partner, right? Okay. Any other partnerships? Here's a partnership here. This is two teams right here. Okay. Diane Oliver is your partner. Okay. Any other partnerships? All right. There's a partnership there. Any other partnerships? Okay. Any other partnerships? All right. What you need to do is you need to go out. When you go out, you need to put your names on here for teams. Okay. All right. Any other teams that want to come up? You say, "We're going to go out." All right. Lastly, we have the prayer warriors. The prayer warriors are those people who are going to sign up and say, "I will pray every Saturday for Grace of Calvary and specifically for our soul winning teams." So if you'd like to be part of that prayer, you're going to come on up here at this time. Prayer warriors, you come up. Anybody who's going to do that? Say, "I promise by the grace of God, every Saturday I'll be praying for those who are going out into the harvest field." Okay. All right. Now, this is a pretty good group of people, don't you think? Now, if you will do what you say you're going to do, and you prayer warriors will say what you're going to do, I think we'll have some success in 2017.
Amen.
I think we'll have some seats filled in.
Amen.
And more laborers on the harvest field. Amen? All
right,
so what you need to do, prayer warriors, is you need to sign up on this sheet out in the foyer. I want your names on here as prayer warriors. Individuals and teams, sign up so we can keep track. And then every Saturday when you come in, there'll be forms hanging in the Welcome Center where you sign up your team and sign up your individual self. Okay. All right. Don't forget to sign up for the prayer wheel, too. And so I would like all those who have teams, well, let's just have word for it. Prayer first. Father, we thank you for these teams and individuals. Thank you for the prayer warriors, those who have dedicated themselves to going into the harvest field as you have commanded us. Father, I pray that they would go with their hearts. I pray that you would give them results, not for our glory, but for your glory, and for the salvation of the lost, and for the edification of those who know Christ. I pray you'd bless them and encourage them in every way, protect them, and Give them grace and strength and courage. Give them words and wisdom, and we'll give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, I'd like the teams that are all set, go sit down. Like the prayer warriors and those who are do not have team members but would like a team member, stay up here. Prayer warriors, stay up here. All right, if you don't have a team but you'd like a team member, you come on up here on the platform. You don't have a team but you would like a team member, come on up on the platform. All right, now, all the prayer warriors are down here, right? Okay. There's your teams right there. There's a team there. How's that? That look good? Good team? Here's a team right here. Help. Bethany, you're going to be a team member? Come on. You got a team member. Amen. Okay, come on up here and stand next to your teammate. Okay. I want you to pray for this team, because I know you won't forget his name. All right? I want you to pray for this team. Okay? Jack, you're going to pray for this team. You're going to pray for this team. You're going to pray for that end team. Yeah, the end, right there. End. Okay. You're going to pray for these young team. Okay? You're going to pray for this team. And you're going to pray for the young team. All right? So if you don't know their names, make sure you get their names before you leave today. All right? Make sure you get signed up, and we're ready for 2017. Let's see what God's going to do. Let's expect God to do great and mighty things which we know not. Amen? All right, let's close in prayer. Father, we thank you for this soul-winning Sunday. Father, challenge us from the Word of God and enable us by your Spirit. I pray you'd go ahead of us, open doors and open hearts. Take us to the people who are ready, and Father, show us and give us words to speak that will help people to know Christ as Savior. And to find those, Lord, who are looking for a Bible-preaching church that they might come and grow and be part. We ask your blessing on all this. Keep us as we travel home. Bring us back tonight. We'll thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you're dismissed.